Today I'm going to talk about X-ray spectroscopy of materials. So maybe something about materials. So as probably most of you know, but I just repeat that for people who do not know that yet. So we started a new group, which is called Materials, Chemistry and Catalysis. We is Professor Petra de Jong, Professor Krijn de Jong and myself. And the rest of the group. And that means that Florian and me are not anymore in the same group. So Florian, together with Bert Weckhuizen and Ilko Vocht, remained in inorganic chemistry and catalysis. So we still do the same things, but we have now two different names. So on my talk, I will try to do two different things. So I try to discuss some fundamental aspects of core level spectroscopy. And that has to do with the subtitle, The Revenge of Real Space. It's a revenge because in solids you describe everything in reciprocal space, but if you do a core excitation, that's not possible because it's a real space phenomenon. And the consequences of that I will discuss in the introduction. But then most part of my talk will be about a technique that maybe not everybody knows, resonant inelastic X-ray scattering. I will discuss both the soft X-ray and the hard X-ray versions of that, where I focus on applications. So how you can use RICS, as we abbreviate it, in your own research. I hope that that will be the main message. What are all the options of RICS and how you can use it in your research? Okay, it still makes noise, my screen, but okay. So I start by answering the questions why you do X-ray spectroscopy at all. So there are three short reasons. One is element specific, so all the information that you get for one element. So that's a big difference with, for example, optical spectroscopy. You can see that if you look at the density of states on the left. I want to start a pointer. On the left, you see the density of states of a transition metal oxide. For some reason, I have two pointers, but so this is a typical density of states of a transition metal oxide. You see the 3D states in the middle, and then below that, you have the occupied oxygen 2p valence band. And above it, the empty 4sp band of the oxide. So the main chemical bonding is between oxygen 2p and metal 4s and 4p. That gives the bonding and antibonding states. And in between, you have a relatively sharp state related to the 3D states. If you now do a core level spectroscopy, you excite a core level, for example, a 2p core level, indicated at the bottom. And then this electron has different options. It can go to the 3D band. And then you create an exciton, so you get excitonic states. You can go to the 2p, to the 4sp band, and then you have the edge absorption. Both together form the X-ray absorption spectrum if you change the photon energy, or you can excite the electron out of the system in photo emission. So it's physically the same process, but it's a slightly different measurement. So then you measure the kinetic energy of the electron that escapes, and you do X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy. So both X-ray absorption and photo emission are element specific. And another nice addition, advantage is that because you use X-rays, you can go to extreme conditions. How extreme depends on the energy. If you use hard X-rays, you can go really extreme, so extremely high pressures and extremely high temperatures. Another advantage is that you're sensitive to low concentrations. So you can measure spectra of 0.1 ppb concentration in the new beamlines. So not only you can see that an element is there, but you can actually get electronic structure information of 0.1 ppb. I will not give an example today, but if you're interested in that, you can ask me about it. What I will not discuss today is given below, so I will not do anything with microscopy today, so no space. Also, I will not discuss time-resolved measurements. So X-ray microscopes go down to 10 nanometers. time resolved measurements go down to 10 femtoseconds. And also I will not discuss very much polarization. So if you're interested in magnetic materials, you can do you can use circularly or linearly polarized X-rays and do everything polarized. So this is the general picture of how core level spectroscopy acts on a system, a material. So you see a material in the middle. So the blue atom is the atom where we are going to excite a core electron. And then the phenomena which you see in the spectra are influenced by two things, by the nearest neighbors. For example, if this is a transition metal, oxygen, nearest neighbors, and by the environment. So the further environment of your atom that absorbs the photon. On the left, I give the three spectroscopies I discussed today, X-ray absorption, XAS, photoemission, XPS, and RIGS. They give different type of information related to the phenomena that you describe. X-ray absorption is very sensitive to symmetry. Photoemission is very sensitive to screening, so to covalency. And RIGS is sensitive to the momentum transfer. So you can combine a symmetry covalency with the momentum transfer. Because of that, you can derive certain properties of your system. For example, DD and spin orbit, charge transfer, and crystal field excitations of your system. And from RIGS, you can then describe the dispersion of magnons and phonons in the system. So I call these descriptors. And then from these descriptors, which describe the ground state and excitations, you can then study different systems. So that can be topological systems, catalysis, magnetism, batteries, and photon capture, as a few examples. So one example of how you can do that before I introduce X-ray absorption in more detail is this is just an example of what you can do. This is an example in catalysis. So we take a catalyst, in this case a perovskite, lanthanum cobalt oxide. Lanthanum is in the middle of cobalt is in the middle of the octahedron, and cobalt is supposed to be the active system in the catalysis. Now, in this study, cobalt was doped with different other elements, nickel and aluminum, which are supposed to replace only cobalt. Cobalt has a lot of options in perovskites. It can be 2+, and then it will be high spin, so then it's T2G5Eg2, or it can be 3+, and then it can be either high spin or low spin in this system, at least. So low spin is all the T2G occupied, Eg empty, and high spin is so 4 and T2G and 2 in Eg. So this is the description of the system. Now we're going to do spectroscopy. I will not discuss how that went, but this is the oxygen KH. The first peak in the oxygen KH is given by the transition metals in the system, so cobalt and nickel in this case. And then from the spectra, we derive the different components of cobalt in the system. So for example, lanthanum cobalt oxide 28, I will not go into the details of the catalyst, is 42% cobalt 3+ low spin, 5% cobalt 3+ high spin, and 53% cobalt 2+ high spin in vacuum. Now we bring it under operando conditions, well, in C2 conditions, I should say. And then in oxygen, you oxidize the system and you only have a mixture between cobalt 3+ high spin and low spin. So there are two nice things. So you can do this experiment under working conditions, and you can distinguish all the different components of your cobalt. Then this is the descriptor, so the nature of cobalt. And then you correlate that with a chemical reaction, in this case N2O decomposition, and you try to find a correlation between descriptor, in this case the average amount of T2G electrons which you derive from the configurations, and the N2O decomposition reaction. So in short, you have spectra, which you from spectra in this case you derive the valency of your system and the spin state, that means where the electrons are, and then you correlate that result with the reaction that you observe. And so this is a very general example, so in principle you can do this on any catalyst, and depending on the conditions under in situ or operando conditions. So after this initial example, I will just go to the phenomena of core excitations in solids. So what actually happens if you excite with a photon core electron? And now I switch to a slightly different example. So I switch to lithium cobalt oxide. So lithium cobalt oxide is a layered system. You can think of it as rock salt with layers of cobalt oxide and lithium oxide. In this case, cobalt is low spin. So T2G is full, EG is empty. And to derive the electronic structure of this solid, we typically do density functional calculations. So that was done in the graph on the right. There are two calculations. The middle column, or the column on the left, is with the Hubbard U factor equal to zero. And then the second column, it's the same calculation with the self-consistent field Hubbard U value. So you can think of this as two different exchange correlation potentials. At the bottom, I give the total density of states, and then separate it into oxygen, cobalt, and lithium. And now you can say, if I'm going to excite a photon on cobalt, I essentially excite this electron from a core level to an empty state. So if you look at the cobalt projected density of states, in red, I give the very sharp empty EG states. So if you excite to that state, you will create an exciton. Or you can excite to the bands, and then you have essentially your density of states of your lithium cobalt oxide. So that's the starting point for the interpretation of the spectrum. So I start with the photon, I act with the photon on the cobalt absorber. So I tune the photon energy to the core level binding energy of the 1s electron and cobalt. So what happens then is the following. The photon meets an electron and is annihilated. So the photons do not interact with the nuclei, or almost, I mean, the cross sections are extremely small, only Mössbauer studies that effect, but let's say 99.9999% of the photons interact with electrons, and the by far the strongest effect is the annihilation of the photon by an electron. When that happens, you form a blue electron. So the electron gain of the photon is captured by one electron, and that green electron is turned into a blue electron. So green is an accidental color, blue is on purpose, because the general many-body theory of photoabsorption is called blue electron theory. And that's developed by Lars Hedin in something like 50 years ago. So I quote here a statement of Lars. So he said, by a blue electron, I understand an electron which to some degree is regarded as distinguishable from other electrons in the medium. So that violates the Pauli principle. So suddenly you have an electron which is different than the other electrons, which is not supposed to happen, but that happens because of the extra kinetic energy of the photon. This blue electron feels very lonely at the atom and leaves the atom due to its high kinetic energy. And then it has two options. Either it scatters off neighbors, or it escapes from the sample into the vacuum if you do the experiment in vacuum. And now you can do two experiments from the same phenomena. You can measure X-ray absorption spectroscopy, then you measure the amount of photons before and after the sample. So that gives you your X-ray absorption spectrum. Or doing exactly the same experiment, you can measure the kinetic energy of the electron that escapes, and then you do photoemission. So it's the same phenomena, it's two different spectroscopies. Back to lithium cobalt oxide. This is the cobalt K edge of lithium cobalt oxide. K edge is the 1s core level of cobalt, so that sits at 7715 electron volts. And there you see the edge with a certain structure, and if you look very careful at 7710 and 7712, you see two pre-edged excitons, which I'll come back to later. There are two spectra given in this graph, and that shows you two options you have at the synchrotron. If you go to a normal beamline, you measure normally in fluorescence yield, or you can measure in transmission, that's the same. And then you measure this dashed line, or the line with points, so that's a typical KH X-ray absorption spectrum. The second option is to use a high resolution detector. It's called high energy resolution fluorescence detection. And then you get suddenly a spectrum which is 10 times sharper. So that's much nicer, of course, because now you see all the details of your Xanes much better than in the normal X-ray absorption beamline. These experiments are done at the same time, so it's really exactly the same experiment with two different detectors. The interpretation of the experiment is, as I said, you calculate the empty densities of states. That was done here with four different ways, so with and without the Hubbert U and with and without Kohol. I will not go into details, but you can see that you can roughly explain the experiment. So what you now do is you take a photon, you excite a core electron, you excite it to the empty states, you calculate the empty states. And that kind of works. This approximation has two main assumptions. So one, the first assumption is that each photon creates an electron with a specific energy. And then you do electron scattering of that energy. And that typically you do density functional theory, or more exact time-dependent density functional theory, or Peters-Salpeter, which I will not discuss today, but that are the standard ways of calculating the spectral shape. And that goes rather well if you do not look very careful. So if you're happy with the general description, then it's okay. But if you are interested in every peak, then it's not okay. And that I call the revenge of the real space. So until now, we could calculate everything in reciprocal space. But then if you look careful, then you see that the single particle excitation model, so the model that a single photon excites a single electron, breaks down. And all these things which happen are essentially multi-electron excitations. Because they are multi-electron excitations, you cannot capture them in time-dependent density functional or Peters-Salpeter, because they are single electron excitation schemes, at least in the simplest approximations. The multi-electron phenomena that play a role are the interaction of the core and the valence wave functions. That's called the multiplet effect. Another very important effect is that one photon can create electrons with different energies. And if that happens, you have to calculate all of them to calculate your excitation spectrum. And a third phenomenon has to do with screening. So the screening can be local of the core hole. I mean, you suddenly have a core hole in your system. And that can be screened by electrons, which can be local or it can be non-local. All these three phenomena create multi-electron excitations, which are not captured in time-dependent density functional theory. And then the last sentence is important. So sometimes these effects are invisible. Sometimes they are small and sometimes they are large. In short, they will be invisible if you have only S and P electrons, and they will be large if you have D and F electrons. To capture the multi-electron excitations, you need a description in real space. So that's really a problem. I mean, conceptually, it's possible. You have to project your reciprocal space result to real space. There are procedures to do that, but in practice, there are a lot of uncertainties, which I'll not discuss today, but that it's not completely solved to go from real space, from reciprocal space to real space. Because of this, there are two ways to interpret X-ray absorption. On the left, the single particle excitation model. So you have a core level, you have an empty state, and you calculate the excitation. You calculate the empty states from density functional based methods. On the right, the total energy picture. So you have a ground state and total energy. You calculate core excited states one by one. And then you create your X-ray absorption spectrum. The picture on the left, you typically use for KHs, so 1S core levels. The picture on the right you use for all the other core levels because they are dominated by many electron excitations. So in short, single electron excitations are DFT codes, so time-dependent DFT, and the many electron excitations are so-called multiplet codes. And then there are many options to actually do the calculations. So this was X-ray absorption. Now I'll switch to resonant inelastic X-ray scattering with the same total energy picture graph. What you do in resonant inelastic X-ray scattering is you measure X-ray emission at the same time as X-ray absorption. So you go from your ground state to a core excited state, and then, for example, back to the ground state. That's resonant elastic scattering. And all these phenomena are described by Cramer's Heisenberg equation, at least that's the assumption, given at the bottom. So you go from the ground state G to an intermediate state I with the transition operator 1, and then from the intermediate state I to the final state F. This is very general, and you can put in anything for the transition operators that you want. What's very important to realize is that you have a summation over the intermediate states and then you square. So you can think of this as a two-slit experiment in this case, but actually it's a multi-slit experiment. If there are 100 states in the middle, they can all interfere with each other to the final state. So you have all kinds of funny interference effects, which are captured in the Cramer-Heisenberg equation. What you get at the end is elastic scattering, but also all kind of inelastic scattering phenomena. So to introduce this more from the beginning, I'll do this with the following slide. So you have your ground state in red, and now you can make all kind of excitations in your system. So you can make vibrations, vibrational excitations that you typically do with infrared if you do direct absorption. You can do electronic excitations of the valence band that you do with UV-Vis, or you can do core excitations and that you do with X-rays. Now you can also measure vibrations with resonant Raman. So first with Raman, so then you excite somewhere and you decay back to a vibration. But if you do resonant Raman, you excite to optical excitation and you decay back to a vibrational excitation. Now Rix is the same as X-ray Raman, so you do the same, but now with X-rays. So you go from the ground state, you excite to a core excited state, and then you go back to an electronic excitation or a vibration, or a magnetic excitation, as I will show soon. So this is an example, cobalt oxide. So this is the cobalt 2P X-ray absorption spectrum. Now with the monochromator, you go to this arrow. So we choose, you set the monochromator to 779.8 electron volts. And then you measure your Rix spectrum. And that's typically given as energy loss. So zero is the elastic line. You see that the elastic line is asymmetric. These are the low energy excitations. At 1 electron volt, you see the DD excitation, and also at 2 and 3 electron volt, you see DD excitations.
Eén optie is zijn Volkswagen VW's.
So, people who do optical spectroscopy, they can say, we can do DD excitations also with optics. You don't need rigs. That's true, but there are several advantages of doing this with rigs. One is it's run by a core level, so it's element specific. So you can only see one element and not everything else. A second advantage is that everything is dipole allowed. So it's dipole absorption, dipole emission. So it's a much stronger dipole allowed. So that effectively means that you only see DD transitions and you hardly see the charge transfer. So somewhere hidden here is the charge transfer excitation, which dominates optics, but that's hardly visible in the Rix experiment. Actually, this statement is not exactly true. That depends where you excite. So if you excite a little bit higher, then you see your charge transfer excitations, which actually gives you the option to look either at DD excitations or charge transfer excitations. So what can you do with Rix? This is maybe one more slide before I can explain what you can do. This is how you do the experiments conceptually. So you have a beamline with a monochromator. You can use any beamline at the synchrotron. The only thing you need is a new monochromator, a second monochromator for the photons going out. Then there are two options for writing applications. There are dedicated beamlines for rigs, which have everything already installed, or you can take your detector and do rigs on every other beamline with your own rigs detector. So this is an example I calculated when I was a postdoc in Groningen in 1998. This is a nickel oxide. What I show here are the antiferromagnetic planes of nickel oxide. The oxygen atoms are in between and they are not shown, so I'm only interested in nickel at the moment. So blue is spin up and green is spin down in the antiferromagnetic system. I'm going to excite the nickel atom in the middle. Yeah, so here it becomes red. That means I have excited a core level. And now I'm going to do rigs. So theoretically, if you do rigs and go back to the ground state, it becomes again the same blue state. But you can now flip the spins and make it a green nickel. So what you now do is the following. So you start with a 3D8 configuration with two spins up. You go to the core hole state, and then you go back to 3D8 with two spins down. This seems to violate spin conservation, because we have photon in, photon out. Photons have no spin. So how can you flip two spins with two photons? The answer is spin orbit coupling. So in the intermediate state, the spin orbit coupling dominates. So L and S, the spin moment and the orbital moment, are not quantum numbers anymore, no good quantum numbers. So you can think of it as the intermediate state forgetting about its spin. And then it can decay either back to the ground state or to the spin flipped state. If you do that calculation, so this is a calculation from 23 years ago. Vertically, it's the X-ray absorption spectrum of nickel oxide. I'm going to excite theoretically at every 1 eV. And then calculate the Rig spectrum. So at zero is the resonant elastic scattering to the triplet A2 ground state. At 1 eV, you see the triplet T2 DD excitation. At higher energy, you see the higher multiplet states. And now there's a new state around 250 mEV, and that's the spin flip state. So the state where the two spins have flipped. If you look, there are two spin flip states, so that makes discussion a bit confusing. So you can flip S quantum number from triplet to singlet. You can call that spin flip, but that's not what I mean now. I keep the term symbol the same, so it remains triplet A2, but I flip only the magnetic direction of the site, and so you change MS. That's much lower energy. That's essentially the super exchange energy. And that creates a new peak in your spectrum. So this was 23 years ago. There was an experimental problem that at that time the resolution of Rigs was around 1 eV. So it was completely impossible to see this. But the resolution of Rigs has improved enormously in the last 20 years, and it's now 20 mEV. So now you can measure the spectrum with 20 mEV. This is an experiment from last year in Diamond Synchrotron. In this graph, you see a red line and a blue line. That's the main peak of the X-ray absorption and the satellite. It's not so important, but you see the peak at zero at 100 mEV and 200 mEV. So this is the elastic line, the magnon and the 2 magnon peak. The two graphs at the bottom, then you do a different experiment. You put your detector then at the magnon peak, and you follow the excitation energy. So you see the excitation energy dependence of the magnon peak, and you repeat that for the double magnon peak. Then you compare that with the calculation. This is essentially the same calculation as 23 years ago. And the double magnon peak understand very accurately, so it has a maximum at the main peak and at the satellite, and that's essentially it. So, but the single magnon is a little bit different in experiments, so that additional peaks which are likely phonons, which we did not include in our calculation. So you can see that in the present experiment, you can flip two spins. And that now comes fundamental question. You can try to answer now before I give the answer. How many spins can you flip with two photons? It's already strange that you can flip two spins, but maybe you can even flip more spins. Yeah. And the answer is you can flip at least four spins. And I try to prove that on the on this slide, and then I'll show an experiment if you don't believe the calculations after this. So nickel oxide has a 3D8 ground state, only two spins, so you can flip only two spins. The Ricks cross-section you can describe by an effective equation. This is not a full equation, not a full Kramers-Heisenberg, but it's an approximate equation for low energy excitations. Here it's derived up to third order. And in this equation, you have an effective operator which couples the initial state to the final state. And this effective operator has the polarization of photon in and photon out, and then a scattering tensor, which couples the initial state to the final state. So it's an optical scattering. If you work that out to the third order, so that was done by Heba El Naga, so my PhD student at the time, you find a lot of different terms which you don't have to read, so that's why I make it small. If you're interested in the details, I can give this on paper. But it's important that there are different factors of different components of the spin. So this blue region, that's a term which is linear in the spin. Then there's a green one is square in the spin, and there's also a term which is third order in spin. Because there's a term which is third order in spin, you might expect that you can flip three spins. So we went from nickel oxide to iron oxide that has a 3D5 ground state. Could be any system, but we just needed five spins. And then, yeah, before we did the experiments, first the calculations. This is the expansion. This is only the linear operators. So you see the elastic peak and you see the magnon peak. Next, the quadratic, the squared operators, quadratic operators. So elastic, magnon, two magnon. Next slide, the cubic operators. So then you see elastic, magnon, two magnon, three magnon. So you nicely see a three magnon in the calculations. This is a full calculation, so that's effectively much easier because it's just Kramers-Heisenberg equation. And then you see the elastic line, the magnon, the two magnon, three magnon, and even four magnon. So you can even flip four spins. Even theoretically, the five magnon is also possible. So you can flip up to five spins with two photons. Now the experiment. So we have a sample in the beamline, single crystal iron oxide. The beam comes in the forward direction, and then your detector is at a certain angle. So you have K in and K out of the photons. And you have as a last parameter the polarization, which can be in this beamline vertical or horizontal. Or you can put it in any direction, but we put it vertical and horizontal. First experiment, we go to the first peak, measure Ricks. So then you see the elastic peak, the magnon and the two magnon. So it doesn't work. I mean, it works, but you don't see the three magnon. We went to the second peak, and then we see the same. So elastic peak, magnon, two magnon. You see the phonon also now, so that's interesting. So you see the main phonon line of iron oxide. And then we switch the polarization from horizontal to vertical. So we rotate the polarization of the X-rays. And then you see the different intensities of the elastic line, the magnon, the two magnon, and you clearly see the three magnon. And maybe if you believe it, also the four magnon in the spectrum. But at least we see clearly that we can flip three spins with two photons, and theoretically you can flip four or five spins. Yeah, so if you want to remember one thing from the talk, that you can flip four spins with two photons. Next question is then, how is this possible given that you have conservation of spin? But okay, that you can try to solve yourself. So I end the talk with some examples of what you can do with RICs yourself for your in your study. And then I divide RICs in the different degrees of freedom that you have. So delta omega RICs is the energy dependent. So then you change the energy of the photon in and photon out. Then delta k RICs is then you change the momentum transfer. So you change the angle of photon in, photon out with respect to the internal degrees of freedom of the sample. So to do a band structure. Or you can change the polarization. Polarization, I already gave an example. So now two examples, one of energy, one of momentum. This is a very complicated slide. The sample is ruby, so it's really a very nice red stone. Somewhere in the ruby, a ruby is this aluminum oxide, there's a chromium oxide, chromium 3 plus impurities. And we do chromium RICs. Here's the X-ray absorption spectrum, and then we did an extremely intelligent experiment. So every one electron volt, we excite the system and we measure RICs. RICs is shown here, so DEF, that corresponds to the excitation energy. And you see, for example, if you excite at position D, which is 576 electron volts, your DD excitations look the same as UV-VIS. So these are the spin allowed DD transitions. But if you excite to position E, which is this one EV higher, you see the main peak DD excitation is now a spin forbidden transition. So this gives you some options in the analysis, which I'll do very quickly. So you can do the analysis of the RICs phenomena in first approximation with Tanabe-Sugano diagram. So three parameters, the crystal field parameter, the system is almost octahedral, so it's a 10 dq value. And then the Rocca parameters B and C. And you can now determine them one by one, because some peaks are not dependent on some of these parameters. So the first excitation energy, which is spin allowed, so that's from quartet A2 to quartet T2, is not dependent on the Rocca parameters. So the Rocca is completely horizontal in panel 2 and 3. So from this, you can exactly determine the crystal field, so that you can do first. So 10 dq is 2.32 electron volts. So you can do it now very accurately in at least two digits or three digits. Next, you can see that also the other spin allowed transitions are not dependent on Rocca parameter C. So that allows you to optimize Rocca parameter B at 0.071. And then the last step, you go to the spin forbidden transition and you optimize Rocca parameter C. So then you take the spectrum E and then you can align that. And then you find C is 0.429. So this is very nice. But again, people doing optical spectroscopy could do this 50 years ago. So maybe it's not so new. The new thing is that now you can do this with X-rays. Huh? So you can do this in a protein where your optical spectrum is dominated by pi pi star, and you can still look at the DD transitions in your system. Maybe a more important application of RICs is the momentum transfer. This is an experiment we did some years ago on lanthanum cobalt oxide. Lanthanum cobalt oxide at low temperature is supposed to be low spin system. Well, it is actually a low spin system. But then the story is that it could be an excitonic insulator. I will not explain today what an excitonic insulator is, but to make your system an excitonic insulator, the intermediate spin state, that's this strongly dispersing state. So what you see in this graph is a band structure. So this is a reciprocal space of perovskite. And it's a bit confusing if you're familiar to angular resolved photoemission, for example. Then you see the one particle density of states. This is Rick, so this is the two-particle density of state, so it's the electron hole excitation. So that means that always there's a peak at zero, that's the elastic peak. And then you measure as a function of momentum transfer the dd excitations. So you see the at zero, the low spin state, and here between 0.3 and 0.6, you see the dispersion of a dd excitation. So now the dd excitation has not a fixed energy, but has a large momentum dependence. You can calculate that, that's the nice lines, and you can measure it, that's the 5 points, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 points, which seem to correspond very nicely to the calculation. And if this calculation is correct, then in the R point of the Brillouin zone, you have a very interesting phenomena that the intermediate state and the low spin state interacts very strongly, and this creates excitonic insulator ground state for lanthanum cobalt oxide. So maybe a question you have is why did you not measure in the R state? Maybe I'll answer that in the Q&A part. So this is a momentum transfer in Ricks. And as a last part, so these were soft X-ray Ricks examples. It's much easier to do hard X-ray Ricks. And what you then do is the same as with soft X-rays, but now you excite a 1s core level in transition metals. And you can again now decay back to electronic excitations, to magnols and vibrations. But you can also decay back to another core level. So it's a 1s2p Ricks. And that looks the following. So now it's hard X-rays, so we can do very easily a Ricks plane. So this is horizontally is the excitation energy from 7706 electron volts to 7716. And this is the energy decay. So this is the L edge. So vertically is the L edge, horizontally the K edge. This sharp thing is the exciton of the D states, and this is the edge. So on the right is the X-ray absorption spectrum, and that you create into a two-dimensional spectrum. This is the Ricks plane of cobalt acetate, so that's cobalt 3 plus low spin, octahedrally surrounded by 6 oxygens. That's almost the same as an lanthanum cobalt oxide that's indicated here on the right. So at the bottom, you see the Ricks graphs of isolated cobalt and cobalt which has another cobalt nearby. And then you see suddenly a completely new peak, which is missing in the acetoacetate. So in the isolated cobalt, you have the exciton and you have the edge. And now you have suddenly something new, and this is a so-called non-local screening peak. So what happens is you excite a core level on one cobalt and the electron sits on another one. And that creates a different energy than the different exciton, which you clearly see in the Ricks plane. If you look very careful, it's also in the X-ray absorption, but that's difficult to interpret if you take only the X-ray absorption spectrum. So as a last slide, what you can do with this technique, maybe I'll skip this. In hard X-ray Ricks, you can do a lot of nice things. So you have hard X-rays going in and going out. So operando is very easy. You can do this in chemical reactors or in high pressure or whatever you like. Your lifetime is reduced because of the Ricks process from 1.5 electron volts to 0.2. So you see a lot of new features, and you can do very accurate analysis. So that's the main advantage of hard X-ray Ricks, operando and a very accurate analysis of your system. And then you can do some special tricks, which I will not explain. If you are interested, you can ask me how to do that. You can still do EXAF, so that's the extended X-ray absorption phi structure. So that's exciting higher above the edge, which you can then do Fourier transform and determine the nearest neighbor distance. But now you can do that specifically for each valency in the system. That's very interesting in active systems. So if you have a redox active system, iron 2, iron 3, you can do EXAFs on iron 2 and EXAFs on iron 3, and then see what each of the irons is doing. You can do range extended EXAFs. So that's sometimes you cannot easily do EXAFs because there's another element which is killing your signal. But if you do a Ricks detected EXAFs, you just don't see the second element, so you can just do the X-ray absorption through another edge. Because you only look at one element, you have zero background, that's the big trick of going to dilute systems. So you can measure X-ray absorption of 0.1 part per million, even part per billion, should be a B if you want. So that's important for impurities and for poisons, pollution. And you can do spin polarized, which I skip. And then my really last slide is this one. So what I try to show in my talk, so if you do X-ray absorption or resonant inelastic X-ray scattering, you can derive descriptors for active systems. So you can follow active systems and follow some parameters. For example, what I showed in the beginning, the occupation of the T2G electrons, and correlate that with the chemical reaction. In RICS, you can look at momentum transfer, and then you can look, that's specifically interesting for correlated oxides. Energy dependence is very interesting for photon capture. So you can do RICS with 10 femtosecond resolution. So now you can see the excited state and decaying of the excited state of your system. Specific XAFs is interesting for operando active materials. If you do the high resolution version, you can do much more accurate analysis. And dilute systems is important for pollution and impurities. And I did not discuss this part, but if you do spin and dichroism, you get sensitive to magnetic systems. And everything you can combine with microscopy in different forms. Okay, that's what I wanted to tell. Maybe I keep the screen shared, or shall I stop sharing? Yeah, maybe I'll stop sharing.